So today's Lunch and Learn, which you may have noticed, we're calling it Digging Deeper this year, and that's so that we can show you the fine points of staying healthy and introduce you to the network of people that supports you as a patient in the work that we all do together. You're going to be learning about bioidentical hormones, and your presenter is Jim Hernser. Jim opened Las Colinas Pharmacy in 1984. Coincidentally, that's the same year we got to Grapevine. Recognized as one of the pioneers of modern pharmaceutical compounding, Jim's 1986 creation of estradiol transdermal gel was the first of its kind in the United States. He's responsible for the formulation of many bioidentical, dermatological, nutritional, and anti-aging compounds in wide use throughout the United States. The internationally syndicated Dr. Phil show featured Jim on three separate episodes as an expert in bioidentical hormones and pharmaceutical compounding. When Robin McGraw wrote her book, What's Age Got to Do With It?, Jim was asked to write the chapter on the balanced use of bioidentical hormone and thyroid therapy. When Mrs. McGraw appeared on the Oprah show, Oprah commented, "Ladies, the chapter on bioidentical hormones is a must read." Jim appears regularly on television and radio programs and as a speaker on the topics of bioidentical hormone balance, preventative and natural integrative medicine, quality of life, and cosmetic anti-aging medicine and pharmaceutical compounding. In response to overwhelming demands for personal consultations with Jim, he has written, produced, and narrated his own one-hour DVD seminar entitled Female Bioidentical Hormone and Thyroid Balance. Realizing a need for better assessment, management, and efficiency in the treatment of female and male BHRT hormone therapy, Jim wrote a decision support software program for use by integrated providers and pharmacists. In an EMR format, the program collects medical history and risk factors, assesses patient symptoms, suggests and orders serum labs, and has electronic prescribing function. Jim is frequently asked to lecture training to physicians and pharmacists in the evidence-based use of bioidentical hormones and thyroid therapy. Las Colinas Pharmacy Compounding and Wellness Center is rated in the top 2% of the 7,500 compounding pharmacies in the U.S. This rating is based on operating and complying with the strict regulations regarding quality standards set forth by state and federal law. Jim has received extensive continuing education in the areas of bioidentical hormones, nutrition, weight management, pain management, natural and functional medicine, including the use of botanical medicines, nutritional supplements, detoxification and purification, homeopathy, and lab testing. Jim, his wife Jan, and daughter Taylor, a graduate of Texas A&M University, all work in the family business. And as you know, this is Dr. Kotsanis, and he and I are sponsoring this program so that you can learn more about what Jim does. Do you want to say anything? Yes.
Well, thanks for being here. We're going to have a very wonderful program. First, I'd like to thank our CEO of our company, Beverly, and she's also my wife, and she's also the chef. So she stayed up, and I'm not kidding you, till midnight last night cooking for you guys. So the recipe is in the cookbook that we have. If anybody wants a book, we have them available. I just want to say something about what we're doing here. We really need to change the paradigm of medicine. And Jim Hansen is the front line doing this. But we need to understand that there are three things that you need to know. Good nutrition, which is organic, non-GMO. You have to correct the hormones, and you have to detoxify. Those three things are absolutely necessary. And the final one is the brain would be the we need to adjust as well. However, if you address the hormones, you're addressing the gut, you're addressing the endocrine system, and addressing the thyroid, the adrenals, and the brain. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Jim here. He is probably the best pharmacist in the U.S. And he also has a form. If you're a patient here, if you learn a form, you send it over to Las Colinas Pharmacy. They look at it. They also can comment what hormones to use and how to use them. And I think Jim is probably knows more about hormones than most doctors in the U.S. combined. Hey, welcome. Thank you.
It's Dr. Kay is quite a resource and quite a jewel. There are not many practitioners out there who are advanced in the use of integrated medicine. That means traditional medicine, natural medicine, putting them together to do what's best for the patient. And I got to tell you, this is unusual find to have guys like Dr. Kay out there helping you. And so take advantage of his services. And he didn't ask me to say this. I can just tell you there's not that many guys who are good at it, and he is. Now, I see a couple of guys here, and I congratulate you on how smart you are, because, you know, if mama ain't happy, nobody's happy. We're getting the hormones straightened out. You may even ask, why did this guy, you know, this old man up here, get good at hormones? And the reason I got good at hormones is because my wife had a total hysterectomy, oophorectomy, at age 28. So all of a sudden, I had a menopausal woman on my hands, and she was a dynamo, and all of a sudden, she went from photographic memory, working two jobs, just amazing human being, to not being able to, and she couldn't remember her own home phone number. I mean, and her immune system crashed and burned, and I saw her crumbling before my eyes. And I said, you know what, I either got to get a new girlfriend, or I got to fix this one. And so that's how we came up with the idea of using a natural hormone on her, because the traditional things they used were not working on her. Matter of fact, she was getting worse. And so I said, why don't we try using natural hormones? And we just thought of it. There weren't any studies in those days. We just thought it'd be the best thing to do, because it's what we came to this dance with. It's what God gave us, what nature gave us. So maybe it's the best thing. And it's turned out to be so. And I'll show you a little evidence about that. So when we try to attack optimal health and try to figure out how to achieve it, there's a lot of different systems in the body that you have to look at. And Dr. Kay talked about a few of the systems. These are the systems that I normally look at when I'm trying to consult with a patient and help them get healthier. And today, we're going to do hormone balance. And bang for the buck, hormones have a huge amount of influence on all these other systems. So we're starting at a very good place. So everybody gets all tied up in natural versus synthetic. And I don't really get too worried about this terminology, because, you know, we always hear natural, okay, that seems like it's the best thing for us, and it's from nature, and synthetic sounds man-made, but to be honest with you, there can be natural things, there can be synthetic things that are right and wrong for us. So what we like to say on hormones is that we use bioidentical hormones, human bioidentical hormones, exactly the same hormones that your body's made your whole life, whether you're a man or a woman. We want those exact same structures working in our body. So you may say, where do we get those things? And actually, we kill a bunch of women and we just grind up their organs. Actually, what really happens is our body, your body, makes hormones from cholesterol. Cholesterol is the mother molecule, and then the body starts converting it into different hormones, you know, estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, DHEA, pregnenolone, all those hormones you hear about, cortisol, they're all derived from cholesterol molecule. And so in the lab, we just take a cholesterol-like molecule, say from yam or soy, and we convert that cholesterol-like molecule through enzymes into the human bioidentical hormones, identically in structure. So here's an example of nature gone wrong. The number one drug in the world up until 2002 was Premarin, pregnant mare's urine. And if you didn't believe it, you crush one up with a little water, it smells just like a barn. It's horse pee. Sorry. You're eating, I know. And number one drug in the world. And it's natural to a horse, but not to humans. Matter of fact, you take one dose of Premarin, and it will last 21 days in your body. It circulates over and over. The body says, I don't know what to do with this, because it's not what our body makes naturally. Provera is synthetic gone wrong, okay? Drug companies looked at progesterone, and they go, gosh, we can't patent progesterone. It's a naturally occurring molecule. So what do? They added some extra chemical groups to it, and now they created a new entity they could patent, and they killed millions of women. And so it's Provera, medroxyprogesterone acetate, is a very bad drug. So there's a doctor, Dr. Spiroff, very famous guy. He wrote the textbook that your gynecologist studied in med school. And so he's the guru, all right? And Dr. Spiroff says that you can only call a hormone if it's naturally occurring in the body. So Premarin could be called a hormone because it's naturally occurring in a horse's body. But as far as Provera goes, Provera is not naturally occurring. So he says that if it, the structure is altered, if you change it from the naturally occurring hormone to something that is patentable, like Provera, medroxyprogesterone acetate, then he says it's no longer a hormone, it's a drug. And it has different effects, different side effects. Now I want you to remember that the drug has different effects, different side effects. I'm going to show you a little example here. He also says that a woman can only feel optimal if she has a balance of actions in the body. So if you had a hysterectomy and the doctor says, oh, all you need is estrogen. Well, the doctor is forgetting what Dr. Spiroff told him in med school. Dr. Spiroff said that she has to have a balance of the actions of all of the hormones, whether or not she has a uterus. So make sure that if you're getting hormones, that you're getting a balanced. That's the hardest thing for us as practitioners to do, is to balance your hormones. We can give you the right hormones, we have to keep them in balance. Here's an idea. If you're a chemist, this is natural progesterone, and this is medroxyprogesterone acetate. And it's very hard to tell the two apart, unless you're a chemist and can see that medroxy acetate on there. Otherwise, they're both progestins. They're in the progesterone family. But how could they be more different? Natural progesterone on heart disease decreases the risk, whereas medroxyprogesterone acetate increases the risk of heart attack and stroke. Matter of fact, they stopped that study in 2002, the Women's Health Initiative study, because women were having so many heart attacks and stroke, they said, we can't keep this up. And so this drug was a bad drug. Number two, osteoporosis. Osteoporosis is the number two killer of women. I know nobody understands that. They're scared of breast cancer, but osteoporosis, number two. Natural progesterone decreases osteoporosis risk. It builds new bone. That's a good thing. Provera did nothing on bones. Matter of fact, sometimes it made them worse in some studies. Now, breast cancer, which everybody is really freaked out about because it's a very scary, emotional thing, breast cancer is decreased risk by natural progesterone, by several different mechanisms, by the way, not just one. It has several mechanisms that protect you, whereas Provera increased the risk of breast cancer. Matter of fact, it was overridingly a factor. And finally, just anxiety, PMS. Anybody ever had PMS or anxiety? On most women in their 40s start feeling more anxiety. They don't sleep as well. Natural progesterone is lowering in those women, and natural progesterone calms you. It hits GABA receptors. Anybody know what a GABA receptor is? That's in your neurotransmitter system. It actually makes... Are you waving at me? Somebody else was waving. I thought she was having a hot flash. Natural progesterone hits these GABA receptors, makes you feel very calm, relaxed. You sleep like a baby when you take natural progesterone, when your levels are right. Whereas... Has anybody ever taken Depo Provera? That's a long-acting shot of Provera. Horrible PMS. 3 months of PMS. Why would anybody do that to themselves? I'd rather have a baby. And I'm a guy. Okay, so Doug Dunbar, Channel 11 News. Doug Dunbar couldn't pronounce my name, by the way. Of course, who can pronounce HRNCIR? But he says, and according to Jim HRNCIR, he's reading his teleprompter. He's a talking head. He doesn't have any opinion about anything he's reading. He's just reading it. And he says, ladies, if you're taking hormones, you have an increased risk of a heart attack and stroke. And all of a sudden, all my ladies freak out because Doug Dunbar on Channel 11 said it. Well, he didn't know anything about the studies. All he knew is that he was told to read that. The reality is that they were talking about the use of Primpro, Premarin and Provera, increasing the risk of heart attack and stroke. We already knew that. We knew that in the 90s. But it just came out in light in the big study that was released in 2002, called the Women's Health Initiative Study, by the way. So I'm watching Oprah, and Oprah is on TV with Suzanne Summers, you know, Chrissy, you know, and she's also got Robin McGraw, my friend, and they're all talking about how they love their bioidentical hormones, and so it's all girl talk, you know, and they're just having a great time. And then here comes Dr. Wolf Utnan, the head of the North American Menopause Society, a famous gynecologist. He looks like House, little German guy, you know, and he's got little round spectacles, and
And he says, oh, all these so-called bioidentical hormones or all these pharmaceuticals, they're all the same. Same effects, same side effects. Same effects, same side effects. I'm going, wait a second. Dr. Spiroff says that they have different side effects and different effects. And he says just the opposite. And I thought, why did he say that? He lied on national television to over 50 million people. Well, it turns out that Wyeth Pharmaceuticals, the maker of Primpro, Primrin and Provera, Wyeth Pharmaceuticals supports Dr. Wolf-Utonen to a very large degree. He also supports North American Menopause Society, which Dr. Utonen was the president of. And so Wyeth Pharmaceuticals, when they lost all these sales, their sales dropped 60% on Primrin and Primpro. They were the number one drug in the world until then. And so they're trying to figure out how to get those sales back. So they buy guys like Dr. Wolf-Utonen to testify for them. So no wonder doctors are confused. Good doctors are good guys, they're smart guys, but they're told stuff and they start reciting it. And why patients are confused and why patients are getting off their hormones needlessly. They just need to be on the right hormones, the bioidentical hormones. We'll skip that one. Okay, mean old Mother Nature. Before menopause, when you're still making babies, Mother Nature is your best friend. She keeps your skin young. She keeps your hair good. I mean, your nails are growing. I mean, everything is working. Your bones are great. Your heart's good. Women don't have heart disease before menopause. But after menopause, Mother Nature wants to cull you out of the herd. I'm from West Texas. Cull you out of the herd, okay? She no longer wants you around because you're no longer a baby maker. And so Mother Nature says, you know, I'm going to start having things go wrong. I'm going to down-regulate these women. I'm going to down-regulate every system in their bodies, try to get rid of them faster. Heart disease and stroke is the number one cause of death among women, and we have 400,000 deaths a year from heart disease. So women, if you're going to be scared of something, be scared of your heart going bad on you, okay? And you don't have heart disease before menopause, 2 years after menopause, you have a higher risk than men. Number two, osteoporosis. Number two killer of women. The bones start getting thin. We start breaking hips. We're going to have a whole slide on this later. Finally, breast cancer. 40,000 women die every year of breast cancer. 400,000 die of heart disease. So heart disease is the big scary elephant in our living room. However, breast cancer is emotional, and I get it. I get why women are scared. Talk a little bit about just the quick hormones. I'm just going to tell you lightly that estradiol is your most powerful estrogen that you make. It's great for the brain. I mean, for protecting against brain degradation. It protects the heart. And finally, it also decreases bone loss. It doesn't build new bone. Estrogen will not be responsible for building new bone, but it'll keep you from losing bone so fast. Okay? You know, another cool thing here is women with good estrogen have less arthralgia and myalgia, muscle and joint pain. Estriol, this is the weakest estrogen, but I like it and I use a lot of it. And the reason we do is because it decreases the risk of breast cancer. It has an anti-proliferative effect on breasts, so it actually protects you against breast cancer, even though it's an estrogen. Okay, it also helps with vaginal health, the tissues in the vagina, helps the bladder, the muscle to retain better tone. And interestingly, Wyeth Pharmaceuticals, our friend Wyeth, they sent a letter to the FDA a few years ago, and they said, FDA, you need to take estriol off of the market in the United States. Well, the only way you can get estriol is through compounded medication. And Wyeth doesn't want compounds to compete with their product. So they said estriol represents a significant health risk to the women of America. Well, isn't it funny that Wyeth Pharmaceuticals has a manufactured product in Europe for women containing estriol as one of the main ingredients? Now, they're talking out of both sides of their mouth, so I guess women in Europe are built differently, and estriol is not dangerous to them, but it is to us. Yeah, I don't get it. So anyway, no wonder there's so much disinformation out there for y'all. That no wonder you get confused sometimes, okay? Estrone, now this is the estrogen that is made after menopause. You make it all through premenopausal years, but then after menopause, it becomes your main estrogen. And estrone itself is not so scary as much as if it's converted to the bad guys. Estrone can be converted to good metabolites, which protect you against breast cancer. That would be the 2-hydroxyestrone. But it also can be converted to carcinogenic agents, 4-hydroxy, 16-hydroxyestrone. You'll be tested on this later, so make sure you remember those. But those two agents can increase the risk of breast cancer. So if you're a mismetabolizer, if you metabolize your estrone incorrectly, then these two guys can represent a risk factor for you. Not the estrogen itself, it's just if you have a defect in the way you metabolize your hormones. So everybody knows the main symptoms of low estrogen, you know, hot flashes, night sweats, vaginal dryness, which almost all my women are complaining about at one point or another. Brain gets foggy. That's one of the biggest things. I say, man, I just got foggy brain. And their mood kind of gets flat or even a little low. And they don't sleep as well. But when I try to fine-tune a case, that means that once I've gotten the big symptoms knocked out, I'm looking at smaller symptoms, trying to fine-tune a case, trying to make them perfect, not just better, but perfect. And that might be, I mean, like the breasts are not as full, we may need to up the dose a little bit to have you have those premenopausal breasts. Dry eyes, big problem, and it's quality of life issue. We make a magical dry eye formula, by the way. We have to compound it, but it is magical. It's the only thing I've ever seen that it just works 100% of the time. So these are something that I might just fine-tune with, but not my main thing, okay? Now, this is the telling tale right here. You know, we talked about hormone balance, and by the time a woman is 40, she's already lost 80% of her progesterone. No wonder she's starting to get PMS. No wonder she's starting to get a bunch of symptoms that indicate that she does not have hormone balance. They can even have hot flashes, early 40s, because progesterone contributes to helping with that. So as estrogen declines slowly, progesterone just drops off the face of the cliff on most women. And so what we do is we start saying, 35 to 40, we better start trying to balance those hormones to keep you healthy, decrease some risk factors. And because what does Dr. Spiroff say? A woman has to have balanced hormones for optimal health. But you've heard of estrogen dominance. Estrogen dominance means that you have strong estrogen, not too much estrogen. You just have strong estrogen, but weak progesterone. So what do the studies say about estrogen? Everybody's worried about, well, is there any evidence-based medicine on this? Well, there are tons of studies. I just picked a few out for you that I thought you'd be interested in. Even though Wyeth says estriol is a significant health risk for women, study after study has shown that it decreases the risk of breast cancer. Also, now this is probably as telling as I can give you a study. They did a study on 12,000 women, and they gave them either estrogen or nothing. And these are all women who had had breast cancer. They had breast cancer, and they're giving them estrogen. And guess what? The group with estrogen had less recurrence. Now, that will freak you out. The women with previous history of breast cancer had less recurrence by using estrogen. Let me see. How did that happen? Our immune system, every day, every one of us right here has cancer right now. But our immune system recognizes it and just zaps it. It's gone. And so when the hormones decline, remember I told you Mother Nature, you know, she's trying to call you out of the herd, your immune system is not working as well. And so it allows chinks in your armor, your protection, and so cancer can get going. So this gives you added protection. Also, as we talked about earlier, the metabolites of estrone can either be protective or breast cancer causing, and they did a study that proved that really was the case, that women with good 2-hydroxyestrone had less breast cancer. Vitamin D, it's actually not a vitamin, it's a hormone, hormone D. Hormone D can decrease breast cancer risk by 60 to 70%, but you've got to be in the good part of the range. I'll show you that later. And also blood clots. What happens to women in their 50s and 60s? Blood clots, right? DVTs, deep vein thrombosis. And believe it or not, oral estrogen did cause an increased risk in blood clots, because when you take something orally, it goes from the stomach right to the liver, and the liver is where all those clotting mechanisms are formed, and bam, starts putting out clots, okay? But it, when you take use it transdermally, it makes it pass through the body. It's used by the body, and it does not activate those clotting mechanisms in the liver. So, yay, one more protection factor. So, just to reiterate, estrogen does not cause breast cancer. Everyone, my oncologists, my cancer doctors, they all agree with this. These are not wacko integrated medicine guys out here on the far right. These are just traditional oncologists say the same thing. Estrogen did not cause your cancer. So if you get cancer, estrogen was not the cause. Now, it'll make a tumor grow that's estrogen sensitive, but it did not cause it. So that's something we got to, it's hard to understand. So progesterone, we talked about women lose 40% of their progesterone by the time they're 80% by the time they're 40. So it builds bone, we talked about. It stimulates little cells in your bones that actually build bone. There are cells in your bones that break bone down. There are cells in your bones that build bone up. And progesterone stimulates those bone builders. It decreases proliferation of cells in the uterus, in the breast and the uterus. Estrogen is a proliferative hormone. It makes tissues grow. It keeps your skin great. But it also makes the breast tissues proliferate and in the uterus, inside the lining of your uterus. Progesterone is the balancer for that. When you have good progesterone, it balances the effect of the proliferative estrogen. Mood. We talked about how progesterone hits GABA receptors, the calming receptors. Women are going to sleep better. They're going to have less anxiety. Also, they're going to have a... This is weird to think that estrogen knocks out hot flashes, but progesterone activates receptor sites in your body that allows the estrogen to work. So if you don't have enough progesterone, then your estrogen won't work as well. So we can give you high doses of estrogen to knock out hot flashes, or we can give you lower doses and give progesterone along with it and knock them out too. I would rather have balanced lower doses than giant high doses, right? And it's also a diuretic. You know, you always hear about PMS, you have fluid retention, and what are those women lacking? They're lacking progesterone. So progesterone deficiency, to recap, are going to have increased PMS. Premenopausal women are going to have heavier periods or infrequent periods, irregular. They're going to have insomnia. Ovarian cysts are influenced by this. They only feel normal also during the second week of their cycle. So the first week, day one is day one of your cycles, day one of your period. So think about the second week of your cycle. That's when you felt the best. Those are usually the low progesterone gals. Fibrocystic breasts, which 60% of women have. So progesterone helps decrease that. We talked about anxiety and water retention. So what do studies say about progesterone? We know about estrogen. Well, women with good progesterone levels had 88% decreased risk of breast cancer. That's a big deal. 88% decreased risk, I'll take that. Also, you think about, okay, we've got most women on estrogen plus progesterone, and the women who are on both estrogen plus progesterone, natural progesterone, had no increased risk. But the women who were on estrogen plus Provera, medroxyprogesterone acetate, the chemicalized version, 69% increased risk of breast cancer. So that kind of freaked me out a little bit. I didn't know it was that high. Blood clots. Whenever we see transdermal estrogen plus a bad progestin, the medroxyprogesterone, increased blood clots. But if we use bioidentical progesterone, there was actually a reduction in blood clots by 30%. So natural progesterone contributes to the clotting factors as well. Yay. What about testosteronosa? You think about it as a man hormone, right? Women need it too. When you were younger, I can tell you, well, some of y'all are all young compared to me. Testosterone increases libido, and everybody knows about testosterone and libido connection because Oprah said so, right? But testosterone also stimulates your metabolism, because who doesn't want a faster metabolism? Because we see our metabolism is going slower and slower. So we want to maintain our muscles, and testosterone will help you maintain your muscles. And it's not going to make you American Gladiator girl with those giant biceps. It won't do that. unless I give you a man dose. And I'm not going to give you a man dose. Neither is Dr. K. It decreases the risk of breast cancer. There was a doctor, Dr. Rebecca Glazier, a famous breast surgeon, and she is hyper. Oh, my gosh, she drives me crazy. She's just like this all the time. But this lady had so much energy, she had operated all day, and then she said, why are all these women getting breast cancer? So she did a meta-analysis of studies, hundreds and hundreds of studies, and the one thing that she found overridingly familiar in the cases was that women with good testosterone levels had less breast cancer because testosterone is an anti-proliferative for estrogen. So yay, testosterone for that. It also helps build new bone. Yay. Now, this is pretty cool, this brain stuff. National Institutes of Health did a study on brain voltage. Voltage is, you know, the currents in the brain, and found out that when voltage goes up, and testosterone does cause voltage to go up, by the way, so does estrogen, then your memory is better, and you can problem solve better. When voltage goes down too low, that is actually the definition of dementia. I'm more scared of dementia than almost anything else. I don't know why. I just feel like that I could lose my legs, I could lose all kinds of stuff, but man, when my brain goes, I'm done, and I'm halfway there, right? And also mood. You know, you always think about serotonin as being your mood elevator, but actually norepinephrine is what most of us don't have enough of, and norepinephrine makes you feel up and alive and energetic. And norepinephrine is your friend. You really want a lot of that, and testosterone stimulates it. So if you have a deficiency of testosterone, what are you going to see? You're going to see lower sex drive. You're going to see muscle tone going down. You're going to see loss of energy, and you're going to see a slower metabolism. What about testosterone excess? I'm kind of making my eyebrows go like this if you can't see me. Irrepressible libido. I'm making my eyebrows go again. I had one lady. Now, this is one patient out of thousands that I had who, when she got high testosterone, she actually had that. But that's one. And her levels were so high, they were ridiculous. She was sitting on a plane, she told me, and she says, Jim, this guy next to me was not that good looking. And she said, I was ready to join the Mile High Club. And I don't talk to people on planes, but she says, do you think my testosterone's too high? I said, yes, Melissa, it is. But do you need a boyfriend? My wife would kill me. But no, not really. And that's what I was going to tell you, is that high testosterone normally translates into you feeling worse. It does not translate into you feeling better. So if we're going to use hormones, the topical hormones are misused so frequently that it makes a lot of women think, well, those don't work for me. Well, one of the reasons they don't work for you is because you're not using them correctly. Because I can give you the right medication, but if you don't use it right, it's not going to work for you. I have women call me up and say, gosh, Jim, I am just having hot flashes, night sweats. I don't know what's wrong with me. And I look at their chart, and I see that they got a 30-day supply 90 days ago. And I said, well, you're not taking it every day. They said, yes, I am. I said, well, are you irritable too? Because I said, I gave you a 30-day supply, so unless I made a really big mistake on your prescription, you know, it lasts you 90 days, and so you're missing two out of every three nights. Oh. And so it not only is it, you have to use it every day, because these are bioidentical hormones. They are used by your body, and then they're gone, okay? So we have to use them every day, sometimes even twice a day. So if you're going to use them topically, though, you've got to use them correctly also. So number one, first rule is, I'm going to tell you why, but you got to put on a disposable glove, okay? Cost you 2 cents for a disposable glove, maybe even 1 cent, all right? Then you apply your creams to these selected areas and vary these sites. If you put it in the same spot over and over, I have a lot of women who are busy. They say it, they put it on their arm and they do this and they're gone. And they're going, Jim, it quit working. Well, they were getting absorption fatigue. It quit working because they were putting it on the same area over and over and over, and the skin actually developed a blockade against it. The body does all kinds of weird stuff. So we want to make sure that we apply it to the inside of the arms, lower tummy, front of the hips, inside of the thighs, and behind the knees. and you apply it to those spaces rotating around. You don't put it in the same place over and over and over. I don't care how convenient it is. We're talking 30 seconds out of your day. That's not a whole lot of time. Just do it right. And there is a precaution here. And guys, I want y'all to listen to this. Okay, can we all listen? Because if they get too much of their hormone on you, you're going to start talking like this, okay? You might even need a bra. So what I want is to make sure you understand this transference is real. I get calls from Children's Hospital. Jim, we have a little child in here and got symptoms of puberty, and they're two. I was going, no, that's not okay. Then we have veterinarians call me, Jim, you know, we got a dog in here and having all these symptoms, you know, and turns out, and spouses, it turns out that what's happening is that the parents or the patients are transferring drug from them to these other folks. This is my dog, Daisy May. She smiles like this on command. It's the weirdest thing. I don't know how she started doing that. But when she gets in trouble, she does it too, and then you got to forgive her. Oh, my gosh. So anyway, she's darling, but Daisy May had been fixed, okay? And here I am, Mr. Hormone Expert. I'm supposed to know everything. But my daughter's 33 years old. She's not going to, you know, I'm not transferring anything to her. And Jan's using her hormones. I'm using my hormones. And I just wasn't careful enough. And we got some hormones on her. And she started having labial enlargement. And it was just from her getting hormones from us. And even though we weren't, like, putting them on and then immediately, you know, rubbing them on or anything, she was still getting just a tad bit. And that tad bit was enough to cause her problems. And I can tell you story after story on this of grandparents calling me up going, oh, my gosh, I was babysitting when you know what's happened. And so believe about the transference. It's doable. Had one lady, true story, she loved her Pomeranian, loved this Pomeranian. And this Pomeranian started developing symptoms. You know, the vet calls me and we talk about it. And I told her, I said, how do you apply your hormones? She said, I always use the inside of my thighs. I said, you do? And I said, so around the house, what do you wear? Wear shorts. And she says, you know, that dog loves to lick my thighs. And I said, because dogs can smell hormones, but I said, well, do you think there's any way that you could stop the dog from licking your thighs? No, I couldn't do that. And I didn't even know how to even approach that subject, so I put her on oral, okay? I just wasn't going to go there. So anyway, if you're menopausal, we like to start, these are my preferred formulas, okay? We'll start with some Biest. This is a combination of the two estrogens that I want you to have, the estradiol and the estriol, the protective ones. Estrone, as I told you, your body's already making enough of. We don't need to give you more of that. And we normally like to apply this topically because we decrease the risk of clots if we apply it topically. It also has a slightly lower breast cancer risk profile because you metabolize the hormones better topically than you do orally on estrogens. Progesterone, I usually prefer the oral capsule. And why do I prefer the oral capsule? Because it has a higher conversion to those GABA-stimulating metabolites. Because progesterone itself does not hit the GABA metabolites. It actually, or the GABA receptor sites, the calming receptor sites. Progesterone is converted in the body to something called allopregnanolone. Allopregnanolone hits those GABA receptor sites and makes you feel calm. And so women say, gosh, Jim, I take my oral progesterone, an hour later, I'm sleeping like a baby. It's not an Ambien, so I'm going to warn you, but it's going to make you sleep much more easily and you're going to sleep more soundly. Testosterone, we always have to use transdermal. Sometimes I'll even put the testosterone and the Biest together so that you only have to apply one cream. I like to use precursors. Dr. K prescribes them all the time. DHEA is a precursor. Pregnenolone is a precursor. They help support your hormone levels. And so we'll use those in a slow-release capsule. We'll put them together quite often. And DHEA and pregnenolone have effects on their own, and they also support your hormones. I mean, DHEA helps your metabolism. Pregnenolone helps your brain. There's all kinds of other things they do, so it's nice to have those on board. So what do you do about PMS? We got a premenopausal woman, maybe 42 years old. That's what Robin was. Robin McGraw was 42 when she came to me, and she says, Jim, I got this prescription for Prozac. And I said, well, do you need it? And she says, Dr. Phil is kind of the nut in our family, and I'm this rock, and the kids are half of the month are going to him instead of to me. And she said, that's just not okay. And so I went to my doctor, and she gave me this Prozac prescription. Well, and in those days, that's what they were using. And sure, that might help, but it doesn't fix the problem. All it is a Band-Aid, and it's only going to work for a short period of time. And think of all the side effects. I mean, I don't want to take that stuff if I don't have to. So I would rather use progesterone. I mean, matter of fact, UT Southwestern Medical School did a study on PMS, and they found that it was a deficiency of allopregnanolone. And allopregnanolone, of course, is where we get that from, progesterone. So slow-release capsule, we'll use it days 13 through 26 of your cycle, whenever the PMS is hitting the worst, and it calms those symptoms down. Now, every now and then I'll have a resistant case where I have to give a baseline progesterone every single day, which they love, and then I double the dose on days 13 through 26. And that almost always works. And it's weird, it doesn't work the first month. I'll give it to you, you'll use it 1 month, you go, Jim, I didn't feel any different. And then the second month, they go, wow, I'm magically better, Jim, thank you. I remember I had this one tall blonde, and you know, and she's about 38, and she had, she owned her own business, you know, very dynamic, you know, workout queen, but she had PMS, and hers was headaches. She would get a headache the day before her period. And then she started getting them for 2 weeks prior to her period. It started when she was 30 one day, and then it went to 2 weeks of headaches. She said, I can't be out of commission for 2 weeks every month. And the first month, she got no benefit from it whatsoever. But the second month, bam, she came and gave me a big old hug. I work for hugs, by the way. So anyway, that worked for me and for her. Now, we talked about fibrocystic breast. You know, it does not really increase your risks of thing other than it's just uncomfortable. I mean, it's just not fun to have sore breasts. And so anyway, 60% of women have problems with it. And so what's going to cause exacerbations, or what's going to cause it get worse? Well, caffeine is a big factor in that. And so we also, estrogen dominance. Remember I told you that you have a strong estrogen, weak progesterone, because progesterone balances the estrogen. Without progesterone on board, unfortunately, you're going to have more problems with the fibrocystic breasts. Interestingly, iodine is a huge factor here. Iodine helps you convert your estrogens to good metabolites, happy metabolites that don't stimulate the breasts. So we like to have iodine on board. Plus, iodine is great for your thyroid. Dr. K probably already has you on iodine, so yay. Also, hormone fluctuations. I'll give have a lady on a dose of Biast and say 4 milligrams, we'll go up to 6 milligrams. Well, she'll be sore for a month or two because we fluctuated the dose. Or I had a lady who said, you know, Jim, I'm only using my estrogen every 3 days, but my breasts are always sore. Well, she was going up like this, up and down. Those fluctuations were causing her to have sore breasts. I said, let's use the same dose every day, but I don't want to use it every day. I'll get breast cancer. And so I had to go all over it again with her, you know, because she's scared. You know, she's just scared. But the evidence says, no, she shouldn't be. She should be more scared, matter of fact, of not having the hormones to protect her. So what do you do for treatment of fibrocystic? Reduce caffeine. I mean, if caffeine caused it, why not reduce it, right? Get the progesterone on board and also get some iodine on board. Now, my wife, I told you she had a hysterectomy at age 28. It was because of fibroids. They were the size of 3 grapefruits inside her belly. And they were huge, and they engulfed everything. And I didn't know anything about hormones. All I knew is that when you got sick, you went to the doctor. I just counted pills. That's what I was trained to do. And so I didn't understand what fibroids were. Well, they're not cancer. They're just a growing, fast-growing tumor out of the uterus, and unfortunately, they are the main reason that any of your girlfriends who have had a hysterectomy had one was probably because of fibroid tumors. So they're painful, they bleed, there are problems, and they cause infertility, of course. So what do you do about them? You can have a hysterectomy. Normally, they can save the ovaries when they do a hysterectomy on these cases. Jan's were just so big that they had to take everything. Or they can do a new thing called myomectomy, which is where they go in and they zap the blood supply to the fibroid, and it withers and dies. So the uterus is still intact, everything's still intact, but the fibroid dies. Cool way to go. They can also sometimes control these with endometrial ablation. That's where they go in and they ablate with hot scalding water the inside of the uterus and just kind of calm all those cells down for postmenopausal women. So, or premenopausal women who just are done doing babies, okay? But if we can keep your plumbing, we'd like to. Keep your plumbing. That's just like a guy to say that, isn't that? That is wrong, you know? Just, I'm sorry, I apologize. the main thing that doctors use right now is birth control pills. And birth control pills are going to make them more estrogen dominant, but they have a really strong progestin, not natural progesterone in them, and so the increasing risk factors. I have women who are 50, 52 years old, still on birth control pills, and here they get increased risk of breast cancer and clots, and I just can't understand how anybody could do that. But doctors don't, it's not that they're not good guys or smart guys, but that's what they're told to use. And so that's what they do use, and it increases your risks. So we got to get you off birth control pills. We put you on progesterone, and quite often we can control this. Sometimes we have to say, you know what, I'm going to have to say uncle, and you're going to have a surgical intervention. Hope not. PCOS, anybody know what that is? You know, it's a polycystic ovarian syndrome. And polycystic ovarian syndrome has nothing to do with the ovaries. It's not a disease of the ovaries. It's a disease of insulin glucose imbalance, which is the number one health problem in America. That's why Dr. K had you eating so healthy. Lentils are one of the lowest glycemic index beans out there. Glycemic index means it doesn't stimulate insulin. This is a very good PCOS meal, by the way. Yay, Bev. But PCOS is about too much blood sugar floating around your bloodstream. It gives too much nutrition to the eggs inside the ovary, and they start growing to maturity, so you have a lumpy ovary because all these eggs are trying to come to fruition at one time. And so it also causes all kinds of hormone imbalances. These women are unbelievably progesterone deficient, and we can fix it, though. They have fluid retention. They lose scalp hair. They start having facial hair and arm hair, things that you wouldn't normally see on a woman. And it's because of the increase of aldosterone levels. Aldosterone is a masculinizing hormone that is derived from women and men who have too high blood sugar levels. So what do we do about it? Paleo diet. Like we were meant to eat. That's so weird to think that, right? How are we supposed to eat like we're meant to eat? Fresh fruits and vegetables, free-range beefs and chicken, those kind of things, the healthy things, that you're going to lower your blood sugar, you're going to lower your insulin response, and these women can be totally reversed, totally reversed. It doesn't take drugs. They just have to change their diet. But if they're not willing to change their diet, then we got to do drugs, right? Exercise. If you exercise, if you make your muscle demand glucose, the glucose is going to go there, the blood sugar, instead of floating around causing havoc. So exercise is huge. We get progesterone. Spironolactone is a cool diuretic that lowers aldosterone levels, helps some of those symptoms of PCOS. Metformin is a prescription drug that I'm not really excited about using. I would rather use a supplement. There's one called lipoic acid. High dose, slow release lipoic acid is actually more beneficial to blood sugar than is metformin. So yay, a supplement, and plus it also has antioxidant activities. Why not? So let's talk about hips and hip fractures and osteoporosis. We have 300,000 fractures of the hip every year. One quarter of those women die. That's scary. 50% never, ever get back to full functioning, and 25% of them have to go into long-term care. That's pretty sobering. I mean, and it's preventable. My sister had osteopenia, which is the first step towards osteoporosis at 50, because she was California skinny, you know, she's out there, and she had to stay real skinny, so she was protein deficient diet. You know, she wasn't eating much, and what are bones? Bones are protein matrix that's hardened with calcium and magnesium. So you have to have plenty of protein, and your bones have to be stressed. So if you weightlift and exercise, it stresses your bones, and the bones want to retain their density. Also, the hormones obviously contribute to bones. So it's not that hard. At 52, my sister's bones were normal because I got her endocrinologist out there who's written books but didn't know about progesterone and testosterone, got her on those along with her estrogen, and bam, she's fixed. 2 years. Now, so the hormones, we have to have at least a minimum dosage of estradiol, progesterone, and testosterone in order to stimulate those cells to build bone or not break bone down so fast. Calcium. Everybody knows we're supposed to take calcium, but then Dr. Rosenfeld on Fox News said if you take calcium, you're going to get heart disease because it's going to make hardening of the arteries. Well, it does if you take the wrong calcium. If you take calcium carbonate or calcium citrate, then it will actually cause hardening of the arteries. So you're not helping yourself. So, because number one, heart disease, you know, cause of death among women, so we've got to protect the heart. So what I've been recommending all these years has been something called MCHC calcium, microcrystalline hydroxyapatite calcium. It's bone meal calcium. It's food source calcium. And it doesn't cause that hardening of the arteries. And I can't tell you how many women have come to me and little notes written and said, hey, Jim, my bone score went up, and the only thing I changed was changing to MCHC calcium. So it is a big deal. Magnesium is really important to help you absorb bone. Also, you need magnesium. In the bones themselves are made of calcium and magnesium and protein, okay? Vitamin, is it not vitamin? It's hormone D3, that's right. Gotta have plenty of hormone D3, much more than you're probably taking. Most people probably, unless Dr. K dosed you. But 5,000 is usually my minimum dosage on vitamin D3. And I've never gotten anybody toxic at 5,000. Boron, strontium, and vitamin K are three others that help. Vaginal dryness is such a problem, and women don't want to talk about it. It's kind of like men don't want to talk about it. Well, women don't want to talk about this, but it's driving them crazy for quality of life. So I came up with a little pellet. It's smaller than a pencil eraser. So it's a no-muss, no-fuss, little suppository, and you can use it 2 to 3 times a week at bedtime, no leakage, no nothing, and it fixes it. Bam. And we can use estriol, the weak estrogen. Every now and then I'll have a resistant case, and I'll add a little testosterone to it, and it might even increase libido. Doing my eyebrows again. For resistant cases, we will use the stronger estradiol, but we don't normally need to resort to that. But every now and then I'll have a case where I have to do that. This is complex. Sexual dysfunction. And quality of life, you're in a relationship, you want to have a good sex life. You want to have that bonding, that closeness. So we know that what I've seen in my women is that it takes all hormones to increase libido. Testosterone, yeah, plays an important role, but you have to have the estrogen and progesterone on board. And what my women are telling me, they said, Jim, you know, in my 20s, my husband was beating me off with a broom. I was just coming at him all the time. And then in my 30s, it wasn't so much. By my 50s, you know, I'd lost that. And so I get their hormones going, and they say, you know, my husband has not beat me off with a broom, but I can tell you that I'm as good as I ever was once I get rolling. Sounds like a Toby Keith song, doesn't it? I'm as good once as I ever was, but how does it go? Yeah, there you go. So for this, we can have, you know, we give you testosterone every day, but we're going to give you a little testosterone sublingual that you can put on your tongue just for those special moments when you have a little hanky-panky. And we can put this pellet on your tongue, a sublingual, and just a milligram or two, and about 3 to 4 hours later, all of a sudden your brain just wakes up, and you're going, wow. All the connections are suddenly made, and you're thinking, hey, I might be interested, you know? And it's so crazy. We found out about the athletes were using this on professional baseball and football. They were doing it right before the game, and they were having better games, and so we thought, well, gosh, maybe this would work for gals. And it does. They get some game. Scream cream. I did not name this. Okay. But it has testosterone and a strong strength, just to be a small amount applied on the clitoris. And it has a little L-arginine, which causes tissues to swell and engorge, which is kind of cool. And it has a little bit of menthol for sensitization. And quick story, one of my pharmacists, you know, she was young and out of school, and she said, let me try, I'll be the beta test, you know? So she takes it home. She comes back, she says, that was not nice. I said, what do you mean? She said, it was like putting on a jalapeno pepper. And I looked at the formula, and somebody in the lab had misinterpreted, because this is the first time we were just experimenting with it, and they had made it 10 times stronger on the menthol. So, ow, woohoo! That was a hot potato. So anyway, you do that about an hour before, because since it's applied right to the local clitoral area, it works pretty fast. And women say, they tell me overridingly, they say, Jim, I have more reliably achieved orgasms, and they're stronger with this than without it. So yay. Oxytocin, this is cool. Autistic kids, that we gave that to them, and they started bonding with their parents, you know, because they have a trouble with that. And so we thought, well, what about couples? Maybe they've grown a little apart. So they take a little spray in the nose, and the drug is absorbed right into the bloodstream, and all of a sudden that bonding and that enhanced desire kind of kicks in, and kind of a nice thing. We've had both men and women doing it, you know, and it increases the that bonding experience, which is important in a relationship. Okay, the last thing I wanted to go over was how you could prevent breast cancer. And because everybody says, Jim, what do I do? Number one, we talked about maintaining balanced hormones. That means before menopause and after menopause. And use bioidentical hormones because they're the lowest risk. Get off birth control pills. Dr. Spiroff says it's a 20% increased risk of breast cancer with birth control pills and risk return to normal after 5 years. But you have to be off of them for 5 years for your risk to go back down. Exercise, a number of mechanisms. It increases the immune system, the immune response towards cancer. It helps control weight. Weight is an issue with breast cancer. And it also promotes the better metabolism of your hormones into the happy metabolites, the good metabolites. What about methylation? Methylation is a way that your liver breaks things down. And DIM, D-I-M, diindolmethane, is also in cruciferous vegetables. And we also have it in a capsule. Dr. K probably gives it quite often. And there's also trimethylglycine, methyl tetrahydrofolic acid. I have to look to even say that. But those are all methylating agents which help you break down your estrogens properly. We talked about cruciferous vegetables. If you get stinky urine, that's a good thing, because that means that you were eating things that had DIM in it, because DIM stinks. It's, you know, asparagus, remember asparagus in the urine? Oh, that's DIM. Okay, now you know what DIM is. antioxidants are anti-inflammatory agents. What is cancer? It's an inflammation disease, okay? Anti-inflammatory, yay. Iodine, we talked about iodine, decreasing your risks. Xenoestrogens and all the plasticizers, herbicides, PCBs, they're everywhere. Try to keep those down in your diet. Do I need to say anything about smoking? I don't think so. Vitamin D3 levels, Luke talked about this. You have to be in the upper part of the range, the normal range, to be protected. So the range is 30 to 100. You have to be 60 to 100 to be protected. So that's why we take 5,000 to get into the upper part of the range. My personal level is 85 right now. fish oil is an anti-inflammatory and promotes nutrition into cells. And when you have healthy cells, you have a healthy body. So that's got you. 1 hour.